We proceed to the next talk entitled Highlights of Current Trends in Management of Bacillar Invagination. May we invite Dr. Jayesh Sardhara to talk on this topic.
Good afternoon. Today I'm going to discuss the highlights of current trends, some debatable trends in the management of bacillar invaginations. BI is invagination of the upper vertebral column into the base of skull, and this was defined by Ackerman in 1790. The radiologically it is defined when the tip of odontoid process remain above the Macri's line, Wackenham's canal line, and 5 mm above this Chamberlain line. Coels are defined and classify the BI into two types. This classification remain most popular and accepted worldwide. Type 1 is when BI is associated with AAD, and type 2 when BI is not associated with AAD but associated with, you know, flat and hypoplastic clivus and SEM. So type 1 is defined when tip of odontoid process remain all above all three line, Macri's line, Wackenham's line, and Chamberlain line. But type 2 is defined when tip of odontoid process although cross above the Chamberlain line but remain below the Wackenham's and Macri's and Wackenham's line. It's a Coel classification. Now all the lines which till date used conventional line which used for establish the diagnosis of the BI is depend on these two most caudal occipital landmark, Bayesian and Opisthion. Now issue is in bacillar invagination, 90% of case associated with occipitalized atlas. So lower Bayesian and Opisthion remain attached with the atlas, occiput. So it's very difficult to define the Bayesian and Opisthion separately in all the case. And other issue is bacillar invagination is a congenital anomaly in which the embryological etiology is occipital hypoplasia. So it means in every case, this position of Bayesian and Opisthion remain variable. So to precisely diagnose the BI based on this invariable and inaccurate Bayesian Opisthion is the fallacy. To precisely diagnose the BI, we need two fixed points which does not affect the development of basiput, the occiput and BI. PIOP line, we come up with two different novel landmark, bony landmark, that is one is posterior tip of hard palate and internal occipital protuberance. The line joining that is PIOP line. Now the advantage of this point is it does not affect during the developmental phase of occiput and thus bacillar invagination. How to measure the BI? The minimum perpendicular distance from the tip of odontoid to this PIOP line, it should be measured. And if it is less than 9 mm, irrespective of the types of BI, it is called BI. So we measure in 268 patients in this study and compare with the control. And the cutoff was 9 mm in both the types of BI. So advantage of this line is by single line, you can define both the types. Diagnostic accuracy is more than 85%. And sensitivity and specificity is in the range of 75 to 80%. This PIOP line just article published in, recently in Neurospine Journal. Before we come into the surgical part of the BI, two most important things, which in every case preoperatively we should evaluate it, and that is facet joint anatomy and vertebral artery anatomy. So every congenital subjunction anomaly, the bony development and variation in each case occurs in, at the facet joint level. So both the side of facet joint should be compared in parasitical view and in coronal view. So in physiological, in normal patients, it is lying horizontally in parasitical view. And in 45 degree flat and symmetrical in normal patient. As the BI progress, it's become oblique to sometimes vertical and sometimes it is supernumerary. So you should record these things. In coronal view, you should look for that, is it oblique or vertical is symmetrical or asymmetrical like this. So in that case, you have one side vertical and one side horizontal oblique facet joint. It's very, very important to exclude this kind of asymmetrical facet joint, because this is the joints which is very, very difficult to reduce completely. In midline view, you should also see the degree of BI, whether you have a high BI or the BI with retroverted odontoid, because in such cases, if you're planning for only posterior approach distraction, it may be detrimental. Now, in this study, in 154 patients, in all the patients of CV junction anomaly, we have assessed the facet joint in the CT CV junction, and we also look for the direction and degree of CV1C2 dislocation in each axis. And interestingly, we come up with the conclusion that there are six types of C1C2 dislocation in combination in all the axes. And the most important, most common cause of C1C2 dislocation was type 6 combined. It means the most common was the AAD is associated with the BI, B and coronal tilt and rotational dislocation in one patient. So in such case, in every patient, you should assess the dislocation, all the axes, that whether your patient have AAD with BI with or without rotation or coronal tilt is present or not. Because you have to, for complete realignment, you have to correct the dislocation in all the axes. Now coming to the most common anomalous vertebral artery variations, in this paper we have defined all the variations, but the most common one, you have to remember that the vascular anomaly always follows the bony anomaly. So and normally this vertebral artery usually goes above the C1 arch and enter into the dura, like in this patient. But when there is an occipitalized atlas, especially in BI, you can see that the vertebral artery goes above the C1 arch. It means in the congenital occipital foramen. And this is present in 80% of cases. But it is practically safe. That is not the issue. In 19% of cases per our study, we have found that in such case, this vertebral artery goes remain below the C1 arch, below the C1 occipitalized arch, crosses the posterior surface of C1 and C2 exactly over the facet joint and enter the dura below the occipital arch. So this is known as persistent intersegmental artery, usually unilateral, but rarely it may be present in both the side. Now, it must be excluded, especially if you are dealing with, you know, congenital complex cases and you are planning the instrumentation within the facet joint, putting a spacer and all, especially if you have a dominant vertebral artery. If you have one-sided dominant and if you are planning in persistent intersegment artery, you should be carefully looked for. Other thing is high-riding vertebral artery, which is usually injured while putting up C2 parts of pedicle screw. So these are the two anomalous vertebral artery variation. Now, BI has a four common type of clinical presentation. One is fixed AAD and BI combination. So in such case, if you see both the facet joints are, this is a 3D view of same patient. You see the, both the joints are symmetrical, oblique, but symmetrical. So this is a simple case in which you can plan for a C2 spacer application within the joint. You distract it and definitely you put a C1 and C2 and it will going to reduce completely. Another variation, another presentation is BI type 2 with ACM. In such cases, you have, as Goyal sir has defined the theory that every ACM is associated with the C1 and C2 instability. I'm talking about the BI with ACM. You see that there is a certain instability between the joints, C1, C2 instability. So C1, C2 distraction with fixation is recommended without compression in such a cases. Third variety, in which it's a complex variety, in which you have an asymmetrical facet joint like this. So one side vertical, one side horizontal. So you easily understood with this 3D model. So the same patient, you see one side your joint is vertical and another side it's a flat. Now, what happened if you put a spacer, both the side of spacer in such patient with the assumption that your AAD and BI is reduced, but usually it's not going to happen, because if you put a spacer, your odontoid process goes more backward rather than reduction, it compromises the canal further, and your patient may have a postoperative neurological deterioration or remain same and fail to reduce. So in such case, we stop to put a spacer, we just put a bony granules, little bit compression, and sometimes we are able to completely reduce it or not, but in situ fixation. If this such asymmetrical facet joint is associated with a high BI, we still plan for transoral decompression. Now, according to us, there are still certain indication of transoral decompression. This is the study we have published with 414 operated cases of CVJXA anomaly in neurology in India. And all the cases were operated with posterior C1-C2 distraction and fixation. 18% of cases, we require a second surgery of transoral decompression. We analyze deeply all the factors, what could be happen. And we have found that case of high and retroverted BI, gross facet asymmetry, and if it is associated with a gross coronal tilt or rotation, those patients require transoral decompression. Still, we are doing that things. Coming to some case example, so 50-year female with a spastic quadriparesis, and we should see, as I told you, both the parasagittal cut, look at that, horizontal, and it's symmetrical, degree of BI is mild. In such case, we can easily, C1-C2 distraction fixation will completely reduce BI and AAD both. Now look at this. This is another case example in which, joint is little bit oblique. I would say vertical on both the side, but symmetrical. So you can plan for a complete C1-C2 distraction, and with that helps you can reduce the BI and AAD both in C1-C2 fixation with application of spacer. ACM type 2 with BI, always remember that the BI is a congenital progressive C1-C2 instability. If you put a spacer like this in this patient, just a 2-3 millimeter distraction and fixation without decompression really helps in significant improvement in spasticity in this case and many cases. What we follow, so in such type with BI, we follow C1-C2 distraction and fixation. But pure ACM with symmetrical joints, no C1-C2 instability, means no AD, no BI, we still follow the FMT only. One interesting case, a 12-year boy with spastic quadriparesis with torticollis. Look at the joints. One is gross vertical and one is horizontal, and patient had this kind of tilt and torticollis and rotation. So what we did C1-C2 distraction and spacer in first surgery, BI is significantly reduced. But what happened to AADI? AAD is worsened, canal compromise, patient developed neurological deficit. And on next day, we went again, we removed the spacer, and we did a transoral decompression just to improve the patient. Still, patient remained, had a persistent neurological deficit, but patient discharged with same. So what we learn with this kind of cases, with gross BI, with gross kind of facet asymmetry, we never apply a spacer, just put a bone chips, little bit compression, and still we could able to sometimes, reduce the BI and AAD, but it remains safe for the patient. Apart from the I'm talking about the ventral approach, apart from the transoral approach, endoscopic endonasal approach is a new one, and it's remained popular, gradually become popularized nowadays. For that, you have to look for the nasopalatine line. What is that? The most caudal process of the nasal bone and the line joining above the tip of hard palate. You draw this line. If your C2 body remain above this line, very difficult by transoral decompression. For that, this approach, the endoscopic endonasal approach, would be very useful. My mentor, Professor Bihari, two IIT engineer and myself, we introduced this novel C1-C2 distractor and reducer, and we published also. Basically, this distractor and reducer helps in precise quantitative and qualitative distraction as well as reduction of all the CV junction anomaly. how they use, how we use it after putting a screw. We can apply this distractor directly on the screw, and then based on requirement, we can distract it quantitatively, which is predefined 4 millimeter, 5 millimeter. Suppose we want to put a 4 millimeter spacer, then we should distract both the side 5 millimeter, so that effortlessly, and we can fix this distractor, so that without without an effort, easily we can put a spacer without damaging the facet cortex by vigorous force, which usually we do. And easily we can, by compression and distraction, we can reduce BI as well as AAD. Not only helps in distraction process, it also help in coronal tilt correction if we use it on one side in some cases. And similarly, it can also helps to use in rotational dislocation, especially in some case of complex torticollis. And in upcoming time, within few months, it will be in the market. So I'm concluding, the PIOP line is very useful and highly practical to diagnose all the types of BI. That's why we called it universal, with high sensitivity and specificity. Our protocol is BI with symmetrical facet joint. We prefer a C1C2 distraction and posterior fusion. BI with gross asymmetry of facet joint, we never apply a spacer or vigorous distraction. Rather, we prefer to fix it in situ or sometime compression and trying to reduce it. If it is associated with a high BI, we still do a transfer or decompression for high BI and retroverted odontoid. Very, very safe for the patient. And for type 2 BI with ACM, we prefer a C1C2 distraction and fusion. Thank you so much.